What is this story? What are the details so far that we know about Deutsche Bank's plans?
So there's no concrete plan right now, Lisa. But what we do know is that there is a concrete plan that once they move into the Time Warner Center next year, that they will create a lot more flexibility for their workers to work from home, work from other cities, and not just be in New York City all the time. Something that's remarkable is how fast some of these plans have really accelerated. Remember, Deutsche Bank, when they announced this move away from Wall Street to the Time Warner Center, they slashed their footprint in New York City by 30%. That was in 2018. So now you're really seeing them start to accelerate this move even more while staying committed to the city in a big way still.
Well, so this is what I wanted to ask, Sonali, because the acceleration that you're talking about is different than wholesale changing up plans and deciding all of a sudden to move out of New York City. I mean, Deutsche Bank had been cutting the number of staff in the more expensive city. Also, Goldman Sachs, which we were talking about last week about, you know, potentially creating a hub in Florida, also has been looking outside of New York. How much are these new plans versus pre-existing ones that, simply to use your word, have gotten accelerated?
A lot of these are new plans, Lisa, and you're seeing the big private equity firms and hedge funds also create a much bigger presence outside of New York, in Florida, where taxes are lower, you have a little more sunshine and very business-friendly regulations. Now, to make this really work, you also have to make a lifestyle that works for them in those locations, better school systems, investment in those communities. So this is a lot of new plans. There are certainly a lot of new plans. There's the culture of Wall Street changing and saying not everybody needs to work from the same hub in Manhattan, and then also changes starting to come around in those other cities as well.
Is there the question of how much people are going to get paid? In other words, you can move to Omaha, but you're going to get paid 30% less?
That is a huge factor here for everybody. But remember, there's this dirty little secret on Wall Street, and it's that if firms start to move their base, then that takes care of a lot of these severance packages as well. We're seeing cuts at a lot of firms as well. So how much of this is just lowering the cost base versus paying people lower amounts other places versus also making their headcounts smaller in certain areas as well? It's something we'll be trying to track very, very closely. The other interesting thing, Lisa, is that people are not just hiring from the Ivy Leagues anymore. They're finding more of a rationale to hire outside of these big cities, outside of Delaware, outside of Florida. And so that change in culture is significant as well.
Wait, there's a lot to unpack here. I want to talk about the cuts that you're talking about. Initially in the pandemic, there were staff cut freezes at a number of banks. Those have gotten lifted. How significant are some of these banks going to be cutting their staff, both in response to what they're seeing economically, but also because with the low interest rate environment, it's just hard. You have to really cut costs in order to be more profitable.
That's exactly right. And, you know, there's only two banks that we really know of, Morgan Stanley and Bank of America, that held strong to that we won't cut anybody this year kind of philosophy. But, you know, 1 month from now, Lisa, we will have big bank earnings, and you will see just again, over and over, how bloated the cost bases are for these big U.S. banks. There's a big demand to get those costs in line, even for the companies we haven't heard talk about that issue very much before.
Where are the cuts coming, Sonali?
Some of it will be headcount. A lot of it, as you know, will be real estate. Remember, you were saying, is it just about paying people lower? That's one thing. But it's also cheaper for these companies to operate out of different locations as well, saving money on leases. So there's a mix of things here. You hope it's not all in the headcount, but we will certainly see some in the headcount.
Just a reality check, though, there's one reason why the big cities have been magnets for the big financial hubs, and that's because they attract talent and they attract younger individuals, and that's been the tradition over decades and decades. The people that you talk to who want to go to Florida, I assuming, are the more senior executives. Is there a sense that the big cities will continue to attract younger talent and will continue to be reservoirs for that hiring pool?
Right now, the narrative is yes, but that concern that the older bankers won't be there to teach them, this is an apprenticeship model. So if you have one banker that's leading you from Florida and the younger banker in New York City, there's a big concern about this next generation of bankers. Now, that concern has existed for a while, but it's getting more severe as there are fewer chances to learn.
All right. And just can you give us a sense, Sonali, who do you think is going to be the next bank, just to put you on the spot, the next bank to announce that they're looking at a potential hub outside of New York?
Oh, wow. If I had to guess, it would be, the reason I would say J.P. Morgan is because you've heard Jamie Dimon joking about this for years, you know, in the New York Post this weekend, and I've heard this anecdote, too. It's Jamie Dimon's complaint that his servers in Manhattan have this great view of the city and not even the people.